Welcome to Hyfindr Tech Talks. Today, I have a guest. He's an expert in cryogenics and in leak detection. He's a physicist, and I think he's also strong in medicinal applications, but has specialized in leak detection. I'm very pleased to welcome Jorge Oevermann. Welcome to Hyfindr Tech Talks.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Hi, everyone.
Yes, so Jorge, let's start from the basic. What is leak detection?
Yeah, it's the way how we find the smallest leak in everything, in devices. It can be in your private life, having a look at your the tire of your bicycle, for example.
Yes.
But it's also a very important thing in all industrial applications, like storing hydrogen, for example, as we're here to talk about hydrogen.
Exactly.
Transporting it, whatever.
Okay, so I know you do helium leak detection, or how do you call it? You use helium to detect leaks in the hydrogen economy. So where is this used?
The helium leak detector itself is used wherever you need to find leaks, because it's the best version or the best option you got for finding the smallest leaks. There's no other technology that you could use to find as small leaks as you can with such a machine as the one that I brought today.
Okay, so we will dive into this a little bit later, but can you tell us again? So, you know, I've heard a lot of discussion of when is something actually leak tight, you know, or when is something leaking? Some people say, so can you define that a little bit? When do you say something is leak tight?
Sure, that's basically a very good question. It's the most important one, of course, when talking about leak detection.
Yeah.
And I brought something to have a easy to understand example. So have a look at my nice grocery bag here.
Okay.
If I want to go to the local market here and buy some apples, or in this case bananas, I would call this bag is leak tight, because the banana won't come out. But if you go with the same bag to your local zero waste shop, for example, and buy some almonds, for example, you will find this leaky, because the almonds are too small and they will fall through these holes.
Oh, right. Okay.
So it's always a question on your specific application. How big are the leaks that you are allowed that aren't a problem?
So that means in this case, the holes need to be smaller than what is inside, so that it doesn't leak out in
right.
that sense. Okay.
If you transport or store something that's big, even larger leaks, like in this case here, are not of a problem.
Okay, so in the hydrogen sphere, and you know, knowing that hydrogen is such a small molecule, can you show us a little bit how that is defined? How does that work?
Yeah, I mean, the basic idea is exactly the same. You need to ensure that the leaks or the pore size, for example, in your device is small enough so that nothing comes out.
If you have a pipe or a valve or something,
right.
or a tank, okay.
Right, all these things.
And how do you go about detecting a leak in a tank or in a pipe?
Yeah, for these very small ones, I mean, there are lots of methods to do it for the bigger ones, because you won't use our leak detector to find leaks with such a size here.
Yeah,
this makes no sense. Yeah. But for the very small ones, tens of microns, for example, you will usually use a helium leak detector that you can either run with helium or directly with hydrogen.
Yes.
And it's basically comparable with a Hoover, for example. So it's, in this case, we have a sniffing line here that you use, and you go along your whole pipe, for example, and it's sucking in every piece of air that it gets.
Yes.
And inside of the machine is a module, a mass spectrometer, which is basically a machine for counting hydrogen or helium atoms.
Okay, so I understand that this is what you use to let's say look for leaks. Take us a little bit deeper into how this works. So that means this is a helium detection device, so not hydrogen detection device, right?
Yeah. Yes, that's how we name it, but it's basically able to do both. We can either use helium or hydrogen.
Okay, so how would you use helium to test a system that's actually supposed to be running on hydrogen?
Yeah, helium is the basic, the standard gas for doing leak detection with testing gases, because helium has a very stable background signal. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the background noise that you get without really having a leak is much better and much more stable than for hydrogen. This makes it much easier to find even the smallest leaks.
Okay, so would you then fill the system with helium and then sniff with this where the helium leak is? Or how would you do that? I mean, imagine I have this huge facility, the huge electrolyzer system that I want to test. How would you test that with a helium leak test?
Yeah, it's basically this way. You got two options. Mm-hmm. Let me switch to the right piece here.
Oh, yeah.
The one is that you connect a sniffer line, mm-hmm. like we got it here.
Yes.
So you connect it up to the inlet flange of the leak detector.
Mm-hmm.
You fill your device, your test piece, your pipeline, for example, with helium.
Yes.
And then, yeah, you have to move along the whole pipeline with your sniffer line to detect the leaks.
Okay, so basically you're moving this along this whole body to see where they are.
Right, that's okay. the basic idea. And it, mm-hmm. In the most cases, you won't get any real signal, but just the background noise.
Mm-hmm.
But if there is a leak at some point, for example, let's say here, then the yellow particle here, which should be the test gas, atom,
mm-hmm.
will be sucked in by the sniffer line, flow into the leak detector, and will be counted by the mass spectrometer.
All right. So actually what this device does is essentially suck in any air, any gas that's there, and check if there's helium. Can you show us how it works?
Sure.
Yes.
Happy to.
So how does it, what must one do to make it work?
Just switch it on here at
uh-huh,
the bottom.
Okay.
And we have to wait for, let's say, 90 seconds, something like that.
Yes.
For our tests here, we can do it then. But for really good results, you should wait for, let's say, 20 minutes for the system to heat up.
Okay. And while this is warming up, can you tell us a little bit what's inside here, actually? I mean, as much as we see this, but what is actually going on in there? What does it have?
Sure. Let me find the right slide. Mm-hmm. So there are two very important things. The one is the mass spectrometer that I already talked about very briefly.
Yes.
So it's basically a machine counting helium atoms,
yes.
or hydrogen molecules, whatever you
yes.
set
yes.
it to.
Yes.
The other thing you need is a vacuum pump system, because without a vacuum pump, the helium that would be applied somewhere here wouldn't find its way into the leak detector.
Understood. Okay. So it's essentially like a vacuum cleaner in that sense. Yeah?
Right,
okay.
It's basically.
And why is it that big? Is there more inside or?
Yeah, let us have a closer look. Yeah. So this is basically the same thing. We have our mass spectrometer, which is here.
There, yes.
We have a turbomolecular pump and a four vacuum pump, a backing pump, and you need always both of them.
A turbomolecular pump, you
right.
call that. What is that?
Yeah, you can compare it a bit to the engine of an airplane.
Okay.
That's basically the,
so
the way
like
it looks like.
Centrifugal.
Yeah,
thing,
it looks like that. Yes, and it's used to produce or generate a very good vacuum. So pressures below, let's say, 1 to the -4 millibars.
Okay.
Because you need very low pressures for the mass spectrometer to work.
All right. Okay.
Right, and turbomolecular pump. Yeah, we are doing an excursus here to the vacuum pump technology, but it's a high vacuum pump which always needs a backing pump, the four vacuum pump, which is also included here. So we have two pumps inside,
yes,
and that's one reason why it's that big.
Okay. So essentially, the air gets sucked in here, goes then to the turbomolecular pump. Did I get it right?
And
what is going on here? So this is creating the main vacuum, and this is taking the vacuum even further.
That's how you could say it. Yes.
Okay.
So these double triangles here are valves.
Yes.
Just for those who haven't seen such kind of diagram here.
Yeah.
And we are using the leak detector in counterflow operation, which is. Because it has some advantages from the leak detection point of view, because you don't need the very good vacuum that you need inside the mass spectrometer in your test object. Helium comes in and goes somewhere here, and depending on the pressure regime at which you're at, it's either pumped directly by the four vacuum pump and leaving the leak detector by the exhaust, or it's flowing through one of those three valves here, and then it's most of it is pumped away from the mass spectrometer by the turbomolecular pump, but a tiny little bit of it will reach the mass spectrometer and will be counted.
And that is what you're measuring.
And this is what
You know, following your explanation now, we see some of it can even pass through without reaching. Okay.
So actually, the most of the helium will never arrive at the mass spectrometer.
Ah, so, okay.
But luckily, Leibold is a vacuum technology company, so all those ingredients here are coming from us, and we really have a good information on how much of the helium or the hydrogen will be pumped away and which ratio will reach the mass spectrometer.
Okay, so Jorge, okay, now we know how it works inside. I'm burning to see how this is actually going to work. So is it all warmed up now?
Yeah, yes. It's warmed up enough to do some tests here.
Okay,
yeah. So yeah, what do? We just press the start button.
Okay, uh-huh. And then what do we see?
Now what we've seen very shortly is we have a gauge at the inlet port.
Yes.
And we need a pressure at the inlet of the leak detector that is below 15 millibars for the leak detector to work.
Yes.
And what we've seen at the beginning, and we can repeat it, but it will always stay there for just a few seconds, is the pump down. So at the beginning, we have 1,000 millibars here at the inlet, which the ambient pressure that we have everywhere.
Yeah, exactly.
And then in the moment when I press the start button, having a look at this here again, this valve here is opened. So the four vacuum pump, which is running all the time, now starts to suck at the sniffing line, basically.
Okay.
And so it is sucking now.
It is sucking now.
Yeah.
Okay. So what would you? You would take this and then now go along something and find the leak. And what would you see if there is a leak?
Yeah, we can try it now.
Yes.
What we see now is the background signal. So right now, the amount of helium that's coming into the sniffing line, even without having a leak here, is around 2.3 times 10 to the minus 6 millibar liter per second.
So there is helium here in the room?
There's always helium everywhere, basically. We have a background signal of roughly 5 ppm.
Yes, okay.
Right, and now let's imagine that this tiny tool here is our pipeline that I want to test.
Yeah, maybe we'll just bring it to the front a little bit. Yeah, so we can see it, okay.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And so I'm the operator right now.
Yes.
I'm doing my leak detection, so I will move along my whole pipeline.
Yes.
And at some point, I will reach the leak if there is one.
Okay.
And if you have a look here right now, you see that the line is moving upwards, the signal is moving upwards. So I know, okay, now I found something.
Okay.
Now I continue with my search, go somewhere else, and you will see, okay, the signal. Mm-hmm.
And what if I just whiz past there, kind of?
It's always a matter of how fast you do it, how far you're away from the signal.
Okay.
You see,
okay,
it works a little bit, but
Okay.
To get the full signal, you really have to stay along.
How much is this leaking?
In this case, what we have here is a test leak. So it's a calibrated leak where we exactly define the leak rate.
Okay.
And in this case, it's written on top, it's 2.8 times 10 to the minus 5 millibar liter per second.
Okay, I just hand this back to you. Wow, okay, thanks. So that's so we've seen this in action now, testing for a leak. So basically, the operator will be walking along whatever system it is, checking to see where the leak comes from.
Right.
Okay. And I do know, and I think we have little time left, but I do know that you have another way when you're not looking to see whether helium is coming out, but you have a way of also checking going in.
Yeah. Right. Let me switch to a different slide here.
Yes.
This is also possible with the same leak detector.
And
I will just stop here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You would just remove the sniffing line here.
Yes.
I won't do that now because we don't have anything to test here now.
Okay. Should I turn it off?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe
okay.
It's better for the noise level here.
Yes, I will. So you go. Okay.
So what we do when we do the other way around, the vacuum method, is we connect our test object directly to the leak detector.
Yes.
Use a helium bottle with a spray gun and spray helium along the whole test object.
Okay.
And at some point when we spray the helium on a leak, then the helium will be sucked in by the leak detector.
Okay.
Will be counted by the mass.
So essentially, you take an electrolyzer, for example, or a stack or whatever you want. And then you connect this end here to that device. It has to be closed on all other ends, right?
Yeah, yes, right.
Yeah. And then this will continue maintaining a vacuum inside that. And then you go spray. You would go. Would you spray? Basically, you just go with a bottle. along, right?
And right.
That's spray around it and then
that's exactly
keep
what
watching
you do.
That to right. see when you have a...
Okay. We haven't used it now, but there's also an acoustic signal that you could switch on and then it makes a really annoying noise.
Okay.
But when this helps you to find the leak even without having a look to the display.
Okay.
The display.
Two more things. I know that we use helium for testing, but some people also actually want to use hydrogen for testing. Can you briefly tell us a little bit of the difference there and why would one opt for the one or the other?
Sure. Helium is the gas that has been used since somehow ever. Mm-hmm. It's the standard gas for the this kind of leak detection.
Yes.
For the leak detection for the very, very small leaks. Hydrogen is getting more and more important on the one hand for your customers or users somehow,
yes.
but also for the rest of the world because yes. helium or the price for helium is going up. It increased a lot in the last, decade.
Okay.
So many of our customers are asking whether they could also use hydrogen. And it's definitely possible, but the problem is, as I already said, the background signal is higher. So the
with
noise
hydrogen.
Level is higher
yeah.
for hydrogen,
okay, okay.
means you can't find the very small leaks.
Okay. But it would generally be almost cheaper, I would say, option to sniff for hydrogen than for helium.
It sure is, yes.
Okay.
It's
okay.
the cheaper gas. But you mm-hmm. also have to keep in mind for hydrogen that we have an explosive concentration,
absolutely.
Which we need to avoid.
And which you don't have with helium.
Right.
Yes, right. Okay,
for helium,
okay.
you can use basically every
okay.
kind of concentration.
So depending, not only cost considerations, but other considerations. Okay. So, wow. Okay, Jorge, that was really packed. Can you give us a little bit of an outlook? So I know Label, you guys are building these machines. We've tried one here. And where is this going? I mean, what's the future of leak detection? You said helium has been there forever. What's the future? Will AI take this away? Or
yeah, of course, AI will also have its influence on the leak detection market, that's for sure.
Yes.
And as we had the example a few minutes ago, then the speed, for example, which you're moving the sniffer line along your pipeline or your test object,
yes.
As we've seen that this makes an influence on the result. This is, for example, something that could be optimized by AI, helping to train the operators and helping avoid mistakes when using or operating these tools. But it will never, will never, you can never say no, I guess it will never really make the leak detector useless.
Yes, okay. Well, absolutely necessary thing also in terms of safety and all those things. And I think another important component that will make the hydrogen economy work. Jorge, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking to you here today. Thank you guys for watching. If you like this, please give us a like below or follow us on any of the social media, watch us on LinkedIn. And we have several other videos that have interesting stuff around the hydrogen economy. Thank you, Jorge, for coming.
Thanks a lot for having me.
And have a wonderful day. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.